My name is Steve Weitzman, and I'm here tonight in my role as the director of the Herbert D. Katz Center for Advanced Judaic Studies, which is a part of the University of Pennsylvania. For those of you who are new to the Katz Center, it is a center established to expand and deepen our understanding of Jewish history, culture, and ideas by supporting new research. But we also see it as an important part of our role to share that research with a broader community. And tonight's program is a part of that effort. Now, much of the research we support is about Jewish history, about the study of the Jews at different moments in the past. And it is much more difficult for scholars to get a grasp of a future that hasn't happened yet. But the future is what we are focused on in this series and tonight, a series called Jews and the America to Come, an exploration of how Jews fit into all the changes and transformations underway in American society right now. As I think we can all appreciate, the United States is undergoing a period of significant social, political, and cultural upheaval, driven in part by political events and also driven by mass movements like the Me Too movement, Black Lives Matter, and other collective efforts to transform how human beings interact with each other. This series, extending over the next month, is a chance for us to think together about what these changes mean for American Jews and to explore how American Jews can shape them. And we're going to do so with the help of some fantastic scholars and thinkers. Since the Katz Center is part of a university, we thought we would begin the series by thinking about the university itself as a part of this era of change. I think it is fair to say that the institution of the university has been very good for the Jews over the 20th and early 21st century as an engine of social mobility and as a catalyst for Jewish cultural and intellectual vitality. But academia has been undergoing its own changes. Core values of the university are being challenged, including the university as a site of the free exchange of ideas. And these changes have significant implications for American Jews. This is what we're going to think about together this evening. And we're going to do so with help from a fantastic scholar, whom I'm about to introduce in a minute. But before I do that, let me just say a word or two about the structure of this evening's program. So we plan for the program to take about an hour, and our guest speaker will speak for about the first 15 minutes of that. Following that, there will be time for questions. And we're gonna ask you as the audience to use the Q&A function to put those questions in writing and submit them to us. You can begin doing so during the talk itself, or you can do so afterwards. On our side of Zoom, we'll be collecting those questions, and either myself or the director of our public programs, Ann Albert, will be reading them out on your collective behalf. But we'll explain more about that after the presentation. I also wanna just take a moment to thank the wonderful staff of the Katz Center who've worked behind the scenes to bring this event into being. That includes Diana Dennis-Walters, who is our events coordinator, and Ann Albert, the director of our public programs, as well as Brian Liscombe, who's our IT, our technology support person. I also wanna note that if you're interested in our other public programs that we'll be doing this semester, you can check out our website, the Katz Center website. You can also find out there about a new group called the Friends of the Katz Center, which is a group of people who support our efforts to bring scholarship to a broader public. So with that, let me introduce our special guest this evening, Professor Sigal Ben-Porath. Professor Ben-Porath is a professor of education at the University of Pennsylvania with secondary appointments in philosophy and political science. And her research is celebrated for its contributions to democratic theory, education policy, and educational ethics. She plays many important roles at Penn, including a role as a member of the executive committee of the Andrea Mitchell Center for the Study of Democracy, as chair of the faculty advisory board for Penn Press, and as a special assistant to the university's president, Amy Gutman. But the reason we wanted to tap into her insight this evening is because she has done such important work on free speech, academic freedom on campus, and civic discourse, which is reflected in volumes like her recent work, Free Speech on Campus from 2017. We are exceedingly grateful to her for sharing her insights this evening, and I ask your help now in virtually welcoming her to the stage. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Steve, for this warm welcome. And thank you to the CAT Center and all the participants in this effort for making it happen. And of course, thank you to the attendees who are taking a part of their evening, 7:30 on a weekday, if weekdays still count, as different from anything else. I wanna talk to you today about issues related to campus open expression and Jewish life. And just as a word of caution, maybe not really caution, but just to open my cards here, I have some strong views about some of these issues, and I recognize that they might, be a source of disagreement for some people in the audience. And I just want to note that even though I cannot see your faces and cannot hear your voices, I very much welcome your opposing views, your questions, your perspectives, and I look forward to engaging with them after these initial brief remarks. So here I go. In 2015, I was asked to chair the Committee on Open Expression at Penn, and that gave me a sense of the rising tensions at the time. So that's even before 2016, both on our campus and on peer campuses where, similar issues were starting to rise up, and we were regularly reaching out to each other to compare approaches, policies, and concerns. I wrote my book, Free Speech on Campus, in 2017, based on a lot of these experiences and the perspectives that I developed based on my work on democratic theory and democratic institutions prior to that, trying to apply some of these insights towards the experiences around free speech and how I was thinking that they might be alleviated or resolved. And following that, I started working with a lot of colleges around the country, as well as in some other countries, with some different groups, whether it's leadership groups or campus safety groups or whoever was willing to listen, trying to really resuscitate a conversation about the democratic role of higher education institutions and what the renewed place of open expression within this democratic role. So what I want to talk about today is really a slice of this experience and this research, which is the Jewish slice, right? Or the perspective of these conversations that affects Jewish communities on college campuses. And so I want to start off with a couple of examples that I encountered in my work. In one college not too long ago, a liberal arts college, a group of conservative students invited an Israeli speaker who is a right-wing speaker who identifies as gay, but was talking a little bit about gay rights in Israel and mostly about Israeli policies. Outside the room, a group of protesters were demonstrating against the invitation and against against the invitation to this particular speaker and in support of Palestinian rights. And they were chanting in protest. The chants could be heard inside the room, and some people and maybe the speaker as well were feeling intimidated by that, which created a lot of tension around questions about Jewish student clubs and Zionism or anti-Zionism, about the legitimacy of interrupting a speech, as well as about gay rights and gay acceptance on that rather progressive college campus. At a different, pretty progressive college campus, one student who really stuck with me, even though it's a conversation I had many times, confided with me that his support for Israel or his self-identification as a Zionist is treated as beyond the pale of legitimate opinion at his college. And he felt that he needed to censor himself or, stay quiet to keep his social relations. Another set of issues we see has to do with the BDS movement, BDS events, and a lot of tensions around them, as well as around what some student clubs call Israel Apartheid Week, which is a set of events that have to do with highlighting the Palestinian rights and the difficulties of life under the occupation in the West Bank. Beyond these, of course, we also see regular disagreements regarding outside speakers who espouse hate-based views. Oftentimes, these come as a bundle, right? So we see people like Richard Spencer, for instance, who is a white supremacist as well as an anti-immigrant speaker. And he's also, anti-Semitic and voices various views regarding Jews and their role in American society. And within the controversy around his speaking tour from a couple years ago and the efforts in some institutions to prevent the events that he was participating in, part of the conversation was around threats to the safety of Jewish as well as many other students on campus. And in other cases, we are seeing invitations to people who deny the reality and the history of the Holocaust or who voice other hate-based views. Sorry for all of these, again, difficult examples to start our evening conversation. So, some of the conversation around these issues focuses on the legal permissibility of this or that instance. I actually want to talk about these issues from a social and a democratic institution's perspective. So, I want to, and of course, I'm happy to talk about some of the differences between public and private universities and the legal boundaries, even though, as you've heard, I'm not a lawyer, I'm a philosopher, but these issues, of course, have to be addressed through a legal lens, but also they really require some broader conversation. Many of these tensions that I use to illustrate the complications that I want to talk about reflect broader issues that the Jewish community is seeing in the United States today. And of course, I think many of us are aware that we are seeing a rise in anti-Semitic incidents, along with the rise in other types of hate-related incidents around the country in the last few years. In the Jewish context, we are seeing ongoing misrepresentation of the Jewish community, ongoing misguided assumptions and conspiracies around Jews. And I won't go into too many examples. I'm sure people are aware of them, whether it's talking about Soros and whatever things that are attached to his activities, or whether it's the QAnon conspiracy theory, which really resonates with some of the old blood libels that we know from Jewish history. So anti-Semitism is on the rise, and confronting it both on and off campus is complicated, I want to suggest, by the way in which being Jewish and being Zionist is equated and sometimes conflated, and the ways in which being affiliated with Judaism is sometimes suggested or assumed to be related to being supportive of or affiliated with Israel. Of course, that doesn't hold in my case. I actually am from Israel, but when people talk to members of the Jewish community and talk about Israel as your country, that of course indicates a misguided view about what being an American Jew is about. At the same time, we are equating being critical of the state of Israel with being anti-Semitic, which is similarly misguided. And this conflation, I want to suggest, is sometimes reflected in legislation as well, both at the state level, where we are seeing legislation that relates to what are the boundaries of permissible speech on college campuses, and also a couple of recent executive orders, which were relying on a definition of anti-Semitism from the Holocaust Remembrance Alliance that subsumes critiques of the state of Israel under a general definition of anti-Semitism, and therefore identifies them as possibly in violation of civil rights law, and particularly Title VI, which makes critiques of this or anti-Semitic, what is viewed or defined as anti-Semitic critiques of the state of Israel, as discriminatory towards Jews based on national origins. So again, assuming that Jews are uniquely affiliated with the state of Israel, and therefore expressing support for BDS or the boycott, divest, and sanction movement against Israel, or criticizing Israeli policies, is really in fact anti-Semitic and therefore has to be censored. So this is the perspective of some state legislation in Tennessee, North Carolina, in Wisconsin, various other places, as well as some of the executive orders that are professing to support free speech, and specifically campus free speech, through preventing this kind of expression of critical opinions of Israel, as well as limiting protest and disruption of events. And I want to suggest that this legislative response is not a productive tool for addressing the concerns that I've raised. So I want to suggest, first of all, as I said, that it too strongly and often inappropriately equates critiques of Israel with anti-Semitism. And in addition, it interferes with institutional autonomy, which is necessary for a targeted and relevant response for concrete issues on our campuses. So it really does not help in both of these regards. I suggest that the response that we actually need to the concerns, such as the ones that I illustrated starting off, and concerns about the rise in anti-Semitic incidents on college campuses, the response that we actually need is one that is rooted, first of all, in the history and demographic and the needs of each institution. So it cannot be a one-size-fits-all response. It has to be a more institutionally based policy response. And it has to recognize that there are disagreements about some of these issues, especially, of course, the political issues within the Jewish community, within the campus community, and within the broader political community. And those political disagreements are legitimate, and they have to be distinguished from hate-based and anti-Semitic expression, which I think we can address more effectively if we maintain this proper distinction. A more decisive response to anti-Semitic expression and action that would have the goal of preserving an inclusive and free environment really would allow us to provide a better campus-based response than a lot of the legislation. Now, obviously, it's not always that easy to tell hatred from politics, right? The new anti-Semitism does sometimes takes the form of, or hitches a ride with, anti-Zionism, right? So while anti-Zionism can be a legitimate political view, sometimes it ends up being mixed up with other less legitimate or more problematic views. And that creates concerns about the inclusion that college campuses allow, and the intersection of confronting anti-Semitism and protecting the right of free speech. So in my work, I developed the general notion that I call inclusive freedom, which is a way that I suggest for thinking about responding to tensions of this sort, and as well as other tensions around religious, racial, ethnic, and other forms of hatred. And I want to take a moment to describe what I mean by this term, inclusive freedom. An inclusive freedom framework can take seriously the importance of free and open exchange of ideas as a necessary condition for the pursuit of knowledge, okay, which is the key thing, as Steve started us off by saying, right, that's the key thing that we do. Teaching, learning, research is the key thing that we do on college campuses. And so free expression and the free exchange of ideas is a necessary condition for that. It is also a contributing condition to the development of civic and democratic capacities, which is another thing that we importantly do on college campuses. Expressing views, trying new ideas, freely exchanging perspectives and visions about all sorts of topics, these are necessary aspects of research and of learning. And this is why free expression is at the heart of our work. At the same time, inclusive freedom lends similar weight to the related demand that all members of the campus community be able to participate in this free and open exchange if it is to accomplish the goals of free inquiry and open-minded research, and especially if it is to accomplish an equal access to learning and civic development to all members of the campus community. So protecting free inquiry without taking steps to ensure that all members can in fact speak, not formally, not just won't be censored, but actually can speak. If we don't do that, we actually create an impoverished conversation where some people choose to stay silent or are encouraged to stay silent based on their views or on their identities. So when I encounter tensions on college campuses, related to any of the examples I started us off with, the roadblocks, the self-censorship, the disagreement around the legitimacy of Zionist views, speakers who are facing chants outside the door of their room, all of these little snippets that I told you about, what I ask and what I think we should all ask is it harmful? Is it repressive? Are Jewish students or some of them, or some other students on campus, barred or hindered from participating equally in the normal activities on campus, such as participating in class, taking part in events, being elected to student governance positions, which has been a problem in some other cases? I suggest that the answer calls for a more nuanced than current legislative efforts allow, and they call for policies that really would make sure that we are protecting speech that is protected by the First Amendment, and that we are protecting political expression that should be a welcome part of a vigorous political debate on and off campus. But I also think that sometimes when speech crosses the line into harmful and unacceptable territories, we require an active response. And such active response doesn't necessarily mean censorship. It can include a variety of actions. But in many cases, you know, if we encounter a call for canceling or silencing or censoring people and views, we should use our broader toolkit instead. We should express our values in a proactive way. We should mediate disagreements and use all sorts of other tools that I'm happy to discuss. Confronting anti-Semitism is crucial, and the protection of democracy is as crucial. And I want to suggest that as members of a religious minority groups, Jews, all of us, maybe some people in the audience and definitely people at the CAT Center and others and myself, we should simultaneously care about confronting anti-Semitism and protecting democracy at the same time. Campuses as learning and living communities have the capacity and the toolkit to do both. We can support student groups who espouse diverse opinions without trying to regulate their views, and while equitably, you know, supporting and managing them, we can let our disciplinary boundaries and practices dictate the paths that free inquiry takes, which is not always clear-cut or easy, right? As we are seeing with the current, separate current debate around critical race theory, as we've seen for a long time in the discussions about climate denial. But we should use our disciplinary practices and methodologies to address concerns about lies, and especially lies that propagate hate. Within the complex, the current complex web of shifting alliances and diminishing democratic ethos, which I'm observing both here in the US and in my home country of Israel, the institutional and personal commitment to campus open expression and inclusion has to be protected. Opposing anti-Semitic expression and countering it with a clear and direct commitment to inclusion is necessary for maintaining an inclusive campus for Jews and for all other religious and unaffiliated students. Maintaining a robust space for vigorous debate is just as necessary and is especially pressing for members of minority groups, including religious minority groups. And it is our responsibility to keep our attention focused on the nuance and to protect the space for free inquiry and civic engagement in which all can participate. Thank you. I look forward to the discussion.
Thank you so much, Sigal. That was wonderful and thought-provoking. So we're going to give people a chance, a few minutes to think of questions. And I want to remind the audience that you can submit a question through the Q&A feature that appears at the bottom of your screen. Just write the question. And we will sort through them and read them aloud on your behalf. While you're doing that, though, I thought I would ask a question, and also appearing on the screen with us is the Katz Center's Director of Public Programs, Anne Albert, who is a scholar of Jewish studies herself. And so I'm gonna be asking one question, Anne is gonna be asking one question, and then we will open things up to the questions that we're receiving from you. So my question, Sigal, has to do with the fact that Jews in the world today, the vast majority live in one of two democratic cultures, the United States and also Israel. They're very different democratic cultures. They're both going through periods of stress right now. And I'm wondering if you could just share with us a little bit about how these issues are playing out in Israel and how they're different from the United States, and if there are any lessons to learn from how universities in Israel are managing the tensions and conflicts that you described.
Thank you for this question, Steve. And I do agree that there are some parallels, although also some differences between the two countries. In Israel, so there are some concerns that I think cross the ocean, right, from here to there. And those have to do with some of the ways in which the administration here and there defines anti-Semitism in ways that broadly capture also some political views that are opposed to the state of Israel, right? So we are seeing some parallels in the effort to censor or reject the boycott movement as a legitimate political view and sort of subsume it under a definition of anti-Semitism, which also has, you know, it has an impact on conversations in the broader community, and it has and other institutions, but also on conversations that are happening on college campuses. We see as well some concerns that I see here and that I feel here in my work around student protests and the way in which they are sometimes muffled or they are sometimes overly regulated in ways that limits their voice and their impact. And this too, to some extent, I am seeing on Israeli campuses and in on the streets of Israel as well, I would say. And of course, the pandemic is affecting all of us. And so some of the robust conversations that we might be having if we were all in the room together is a little bit more limited, right, when we are seeing each other mostly virtually. I would say that in Israel, the erosion of the democratic culture has been more rapid and more concerning to me. And so, to some extent, some of the similar trends that we see here, for example, the limits on protests, on the streets and on campus, I see it over there as well, but in a more sustained and pronounced way. I think the reduction of trust in government may be more pronounced here, but it's taking effect over there as well, right? So there are some similar trends, but they have a different intensity. One thing that I saw literally like cross the ocean, you know, was some of the efforts from outside groups over here to affect what is happening on college campuses, and particularly to try and portray campuses as unreasonably or illegitimately left-leaning, progressive, unfair towards conservative views. And so, which is, you know, a concern that even if true is being, or even if it has a grain of truth, right, is amplified and exaggerated by some conservative outside groups. And these same groups are making some similar efforts in Israeli college campuses. And so this is not like cultural trends, it's an actual effort to replicate some of these instances on both sides of the ocean.
Let me turn things over to Anne now.
Okay, thank you so much, Sigal. This has been really already so thought-provoking. I have, you know, pages laid out in front of me with lots of questions, and we also have lots of questions coming in from the Q&A, so I'm going to do my best to manage. I'll just throw out the question that was on my mind was that I know that you've written and thought about the idea of civility, and civility is something that's been on a lot of people's minds in recent days and weeks. And so I wanted to more or less just invite you to speak a little bit about the place of civility in handling difficult issues, especially on campus, whether you think that that's a helpful framing for the way that we should be striving to speak to each other in an academic setting, if there are times when the abandonment of civility might be warranted, and you know how to face the abject lack of civility when you see it.
Great, thank you for the opportunity to say something about a topic that I'm very passionate about. And my passion goes a little bit against the grain in this regard. I really think civility is the wrong framework for us to use when we are looking to create a significant, meaningful, passionate exchange in the public sphere, and particularly in a sustained learning community such as a campus is supposed to be and oftentimes is. I think we can talk about civility in the public domain. You know, there is room to look for more dignity, you know, or more adherence to norms. I think there is room for that when you talk about exchanges that take place in a public domain. But I think in the context of a learning community where people really know each other over time and they have ongoing exchanges, right? And the relationship is, at least to some extent, more personal. I mean, even if it's professional in nature, it's more personal in the sense that it's sustained and ongoing. I think we can talk about reasonable norms for conversation in a specific classroom or a specific context. right? So if, for example, you know, I teach a class and I say, look, you know, I would like for you to raise your hand if you want to speak, or you can just jump in, right? These are norms that I set. They have nothing to do with civility. They're just trying to organize the conversation. But I think civility actually is a pretty stifling concept. And here is why. First of all, civility requires that we, everyone adheres by the norms that somebody set, right? So if I'm in power in my classroom and I'm saying, don't raise your voice. And let's say, Anne, that you want to say something and I consistently am not letting you speak. And I also say, you know, women in my classroom, let's say, or right, they don't, you know, they don't have real contributions. I'm only going to let men speak. And finally, you're, you know, you're frustrated and you're saying, listen here, I have something that I'm really, you know, really burning to say here. Ah, you're being uncivil, right? But who is wrong here? I'm wrong in this story because the framework that I should use in my classroom and in the campus more broadly is a framework of equity and not the framework of civility, which can really silence some people, right? And also I can use my time, as in the example, you know, kind of crude example that I was just giving, I can use the microphone and use my time to say, for example, that I don't think very highly about women or about whichever group, or maybe about you personally for whatever reason, right? If you, right? And I can say that in a perfectly civil way. You know, I can, you know, wear my dress shirt and I can be speaking in a nice voice and, you know, I'm not using any curse words. So I'm being civil, but I'm still unjust. Right? So what's important for a learning community is really not civility. It's a different thing, right? And this is what I'm trying to say when I'm talking about either justice or equity in this context.
Thank you very much for that. Okay, we have a number of questions. What I'm gonna do is for all of you who are typing in questions, you may not hear your exact question read out directly because a few of them are sort of clustering around certain issues. So I'm gonna try to combine some things. So we have a few questions that really hone in on differentiating or distinguishing between the unacceptable and the unacceptable. We have a question, who determines the threshold of what's harmful? And how is that set? And there's a question that I'll partially read. Someone says, I like the question we should ask ourselves, which is, does the lack of participation preclude people from equal participation? Can you say more about this, right? So again, and it goes on, can you say, a Jewish student might say that being Ben Shapiro harms them, and another Jewish student says that refusing to bring him harms them, right? So how does it actually play out? And are there some standards and some frameworks for making that differentiation?
Great. No, so that's a great question. And I often am asked, you know, where do you draw the line? And I say right here, there, there you have it. But it's of course very hard to make a decision about specific cases. And I appreciate the examples and I appreciate also the general question about the threshold that you started us with and here. I would say that the way that I try to think about it through the lens of harm that one of the questions focused on is to try and distinguish between dignitary harms and intellectual harms, right? So give me two sentences and I think that's gonna be clear. So when we worry about the dignitary harms, what we worry about is expression or action, which really sets me up to look at myself as an unequal member of the community. So for example, again, if I'm sitting in a class as a student and the professor consistently is talking down about women, and maybe the professor, you know, has some research that they want to explore, and they, you know, as in the case, maybe some people remember of the former president of Harvard at one point who said, oh, maybe people, sorry about that, maybe people, maybe women don't have the capacity to be very successful in math and science. I'm just asking a question. I'm just exploring the possibility. I don't think the view in itself is beyond the pale. I think it's silly, but I think, you know, it's definitely not inappropriate to discuss if somebody is so inclined to do. But I think if you do it as the president of Harvard, or if you do it when you are teaching math in a class, right, and you're saying my female students probably are not, you know, gonna be as successful because women don't have the brain for math, this I think causes actual harm in terms of students, in this case women, but of course this can apply to any group, feeling that they are not equal members of the community, they cannot be as successful, and so they are undermined in their capacity to equally participate. On the other hand, the intellectual harms that we should worry about is when we don't expose people to enough diverse views, right? And therefore we are sheltering them and we're not allowing them to explore and pursue possible alternative opinions and views and domains, right? And so we need to try and avoid both types of harms, right? But one of them calls for less speech and the other calls for more speech. This is the effort here, right? I don't want to hear speech that causes dignitary harm, but I want to hear more speech so that I don't shelter my students or shelter my community from even difficult views. Look, anti-Semitic views, okay? Are they permissible? Obviously, I think they cause dignitary harm, right? Obviously, they commonly are based on either just hatred, but oftentimes on lies, right? On inaccurate views about Jews. And the same goes for, you know, misogynistic views, racist views, right? So different views that are based on hate. So should I shelter my students from ever hearing anything like that? I think it's a balancing act. And the reason for that is that these views exist in the outside community. And I got to figure out a way to expose my students in a productive manner, right? So to expose them without seeming to espouse any of these values or perspectives, and helping them develop the tools, including both argumentation and resilience, to address some of these concerns that we are seeing in the broader community and sometimes within our own home being campus.
So then I think the follow-up question, which was partially in the questions that were already asked and connects to another one, is then who makes that call? Not just how do you do it and what do you take into consideration, but who makes it? And then that's connected with the question of realistic policies. So someone asked if you could talk about, what realistic advice do you have? There's one asking about specific policies that meet these principles that have been put into place in wherever, at Penn or somewhere else, and that have worked.
Great. So that's a great question. And just, you know, and you should whistle or make some more if I talk too much about this, because I'm really like in the weeds of this, both at Penn and outside of Penn. Penn has a really good set of guidelines on open expression. If you just Google that, Penn guidelines on open expression, they were developed initially in the 1970s after the sweatshop riots, if some people in the audience remember that. and have been updated since. And so, you know, while I was the chair of the Committee on Open Expression in the last few years, this committee is responsible for enforcing or adjudicating, you know, the implementation of these guidelines. But of course, I didn't develop them. They are longstanding and they are pretty successful, but they are really written, I have to warn you, in legalese, right? So there is a legal document that really talks about when and how people might, or when and how speech can ever be constrained or limited. And it's really not very often, right? So it's really, these are guidelines that are trying to keep speech quite often. There are other institutions that have developed guidelines, some of which I've been helping to develop in the last few years, that are more communicative to their audience, right? To their students and their faculty and the people who work within the community. And, you know, if people have an interest, I'm always happy to share those. Williams College has pretty good guidelines, Michigan has. So, you know, so there are different places that have developed very thoughtful guidelines for open expression, but I want to say something about their substance. And this goes back to who gets to decide, which was the other part of the question, right? What's important in my view is that if you have a committee like Penn's Committee on Open Expression or other similar committees, they have to be representative of the main constituencies on campus, right? So we have faculty and staff and students. We have weekly paid staff. So we have people who represent the different constituencies on campus. And there is an ongoing discussion about how do we apply the principles. For example, what happens with social media posts, right? You know, can I adjudicate something that you put on Facebook, right? As the Committee on Open Expression, right? So where does my power end, right? Such as it is. So these are questions that we need to discuss within our community through representatives. And if we want to make significant changes, through an open discussion within our community, the university council or other similar open forums. In my view, and this is the reason why I spoke a little bit, you know, in a more critical way about not just the content of recent legislation around BDS and anti-Semitism, etc., but really about the idea that you can legislate that. The United States has 4,000, give or take, higher education institutions, right? They are community colleges, about half of them, right? Junior colleges, they are public and private and regional, they are HBCUs, right? So historically black colleges and universities, they are Hispanic serving, they are, I mean, you name it, right? That some of them are women's colleges, they are research universities, they are liberal arts, you know, small, tiny little. How can you create one rule that reasonably applies to all of them about speech, right? I really think that even my examples about women that I gave, you know, in our exchange, Anne, I think they have a different flavor and a different application if they operate at Bryn Mawr, which is a women or historically a women's institution. Right, is different than at Penn. I think conversations about anti-Semitism at Brandeis are different to some extent than they are at Princeton, okay? So these are gonna be contextual, right? And so who decide? The community decides. And I have some nice templates, but they cannot be cut and pasted, right? They need to be adjusted to the institutional history and demographic and context.
Thank you. It's really helpful. I find it very helpful to think about, you know, if speech is something that only happens between people, then regulation of speech also is something that has to happen among those people. And it's a very nice construction. Okay, so I have a question. Someone's asking if you could please expand on the self-censorship problem that you mentioned. And they ask what tools you could recommend to address it, but I'm sure we'd also like to just hear a little bit more about how it works and how it happens.
Right. So, okay, so this is an issue that I think many places and many campuses are facing. Sometimes it's described right now as cancel culture, right? In the sense that, you know, I worry so much what you might think if you hear my views that, you know, either I silence myself or if I say it out loud, then you go around and make sure that I get fired or that people don't talk to me, right? So you cancel me, right? So that's sort of this conversation. I'll talk about this, but I just want to say that I don't think it's as huge a problem as it's sometimes portrayed to be. I think it's, you know, taken on a life of its own in the culture wars and in the public debate. I think it's there and we should address it. I'm not immensely worried about it, right? But let me say something about it nonetheless. I think the concerns about self-censorship and reports from students, and especially at least on many more selective colleges and university campuses and more progressive ones, we hear more concerns related to, I'm sorry about the pings here. I don't know how to silence them. So I'm just going to ignore them. Oh, okay. Concerns regarding the silencing of conservative, sometimes religious, sometimes politically right-wing views. And these really happen in our classrooms, right? And I think the main, so, and the way that they happen is because the majority of many campuses is more progressive. Right, this is a, you know, well-surveyed, right, information. It's not bad-mouthing, right? It's really true. And it's true for the most part, I think, because at this day and age and in this polarized country, level of education is strongly tied to political ideology. Right. And so on campus, you have more highly educated people. And this group tends to be more progressive, not to speak about the fact that we have so many more campuses on the coast that also and in cities, right. So areas that tend to be more progressive. And so people who are conservative or, you know, have other minority views on whatever topic, you know, want to preserve their social relations, and so they remain silent. I think the way to address that is by really making an effort as an institution to recognize that people with minority views and ideologies, minority on campus, right? They actually make a significant contribution to the campus culture, which nobody else can make. Right? So the more monochromatic in terms of, you know, ideology a campus is, the more it tends to even constrict, further constrict permissible views. And we see that in the increasing purity tests that student groups and other groups, it's not just students, right, develop when there is limited ideological diversity or viewpoint diversity, right? The more we think the same, the more I'm going to try to distinguish myself by showing that I'm even more so. You know, I hold this opinion even more strongly, right? And so we demand more and more purity to the extent that really we lose touch with the significant problems that we want to solve or with the diversity of opinion that is around us. People who hold, less common views really help us recognize first of all, the diversity of opinion within the broader culture and country, which we really have to be aware of, and we have to recognize and learn to converse with, right? And they also help us mitigate some of these concerns about the tendency of groups that have similar views within them to become, you know, to self-radicalize, so to speak, to become more and more extreme within the view that they hold. And so this can be done if we properly work with faculty and instructors about how to support diversity of opinion within their classroom in productive ways. We can do it by supporting more actively student organizations that hold more minority views on college campuses. It's less of a problem on a campus like ours, to some extent, because the campus is so diverse in terms of ideology and perspective, right? But it's really a problem, again, just going back to Bryn Mawr as a neighbor, right? But on other, you know, smaller, more insular and more progressive, mostly like colleges, not universities. So, you know, you have to take active steps to try and mitigate that.
Wonderful. So we're getting very close to the end. We probably have time for about one more question. So I want to give Steve Weitzman a chance to throw in more a question if you have something burning, Steve. Otherwise, we have more to turn to from the audience.
So maybe I'll conclude with one last question. And I was thinking as you were speaking, Sigal, that the very issues you're talking about are alive with this very medium, right? We came with this medium, which, you know, limits audience participation because we were so worried about Zoom bombing with hate speech and, you know, people disrupting the free exchange. So it's a struggle that's ongoing, and it's, you know, something that we had to think about in this very event. But I do want to maybe conclude by asking you about a common kind of misperception of the university. And this is kind of related to the question that just came up, as the source of the political correctness that is alleged to be so repressive in American society. And I think in the 2016 election, part of what led to the outcome of that election was a kind of backlash against this idea of kind of East Coast elites, especially university elites, trying to control thought. And I'm wondering if you have thoughts about how universities can overcome that misperception, what they can do to disseminate the value of the free exchange of ideas, and to avoid people thinking that universities are repressive, intellectually repressive places.
Right. Thank you for that question, Steve. And I just want to say that I think, okay, so I have a couple of thoughts on that, but let's start this way. I think the attack or the critique of college campuses as the source of like PC culture or you know, being elitist and ignoring the needs of the people or whatever that might be, I think this is a part of a broader effort to undermine the institutions that are arbiters of truth in society, right? And so we see that along with the attack on the free press, attacks on science more broadly, not only just university-based science, but also science as has to do with the epidemics or with the climate, etc. So I think the effort to undermine the arbiters of truth in society is a part of a separate cultural phenomenon that campuses are get wrapped up in, right? So this is the ways or it's sort of like the shape that the culture war is taking right now. And I want to suggest that one of the ways in which we can address this is really by trying to reflect publicly as, you know, definitely as leaders or faculty in the university community, but also as students and instructors and anyone who is involved in the campus community, to try and reflect that while, of course, we have all sorts of limitations and things to improve on, and we just devoted the last hour, right, to think about some of those and about ways to address them, self-censorship or limited ideological diversity or other concerns about equity, et cetera. But really, where free speech thrives more than any other institution in American society is on campus, right? Where else do you have such a sustained and robust exchange of views, you know, such a shared effort to expand our knowledge by learning from each other, by asking hard questions, by inviting, you know, speakers with different types of knowledge and perspectives? Where else do you do that? You really don't do it in the halls of government. You don't do it in most places, right? I mean, half the media is not open to the exchange of diverse opinions. It's a really higher education that is preserving the First Amendment, I think, for American society. And of course, we have to always be vigilant and make sure that we're doing it right and to correct ourselves, etc. But I really think that we need to learn to not be shy about representing the work that we do in protecting open expression on college campuses. And I just, this afternoon, I was a part of a talk at the Andrea Mitchell Center for the Study of Democracy, where I'm chairing the committee that plans the events for this year. And we had the CEO of the New York Times talking about the free press and some of the challenges that they are facing. And so I think there are some similarities in the struggle that we are all a part of in terms of the attacks on truth as in themselves, right, a part of the political moment that we are in. If I could, can I say one more word? I know we are kind of past time, but I just want to plug in some of the events that we are doing also later this year. We have an event in November 19, that focuses on BDS and the boycott movements. That's gonna be, I think, maybe of interest to some of the people in the audience. And most significantly, and this is a plug, but it's also a way to sort of like summarize some of these thoughts. On October 29, we are hosting Derek Black, who is currently a doctoral student at the University of Chicago, but he was raised as a white supremacist. And he was really the founder of one of the websites that is most widely trafficked of the white nationalist, white supremacist movement in the United States. David Duke was his godfather. So he really grew up at the heart of the white nationalist, white supremacist movement, neo-Nazi movement in the United States. And going to, and you can see the events, thank you, Anne, at the in the chat box. Going to a small college after he finished high school, he continued running his talk radio show that was propagating neo-Nazi and white supremacist ideas. And at the same time, he befriended a group of students in his dorms, some of whom were Jewish, and started inviting him to Shabbat dinners, not knowing his other, you know, day job. And he, through his friendship with them, and through the ongoing conversation, including after he was outed as a white supremacist, as an active white supremacist, continued inviting him to Shabbat dinners and discussing his views with him and trying to dissuade him of these perspectives, he changed his mind and he disavowed his views. And he's now a very active anti-racist activist, as well as I noted, a doctoral student in Chicago. And I really think that speaks to the importance of a sustained and open conversation, including about views in his case, that are way beyond the pale of what is legitimate, in my view, in our political community. But how productive a conversation like this can be when it turns a person's view from all the way over there into a mainstream and even an activism for justice.
Thank you. So I know we're leaving questions unaddressed, and I apologize to those who didn't get their questions responded to, but what Professor Ben-Porath has been talking about is so foundational to the kind of conversation we want to encourage. So I want to thank her so much for sharing such thoughtful and constructive insights with us about these difficult and issues that are often misperceived. And I want to invite all of you in the audience to keep joining us in the series as it continues to unfold. Next week, on Tuesday, we will be talking about the Me Too movement and the Jewish community, which is a very, very important conversation to have. So thank you for coming tonight. I hope you'll join us in the future. And again, my sincere thanks to Professor Ben-Porath for sharing her wisdom with us. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Steve. And thank you, Anne, for this invitation. I really enjoyed that. And if people didn't have their questions answered, I'm always happy for them to reach out to me. And I'm happy to have a conversation about this in private. Thank you.
Thank you so much.